Hey, Darvin, I don't know if, like, last game, you almost separate the times when you had the rotations. You're expecting to be playing some and then the end of the game group, but I want to ask you about those first two groups, what you saw on both ends of the court.
I saw a great deal of carryover from our film session we had this morning, our shoot-around. A great improvement from game one to game two of the preseason. And just a focus to do the little things, and we pinpointed some stuff defensively. Off the ball, in the pick and roll that we wanted to improve, and I thought we did that tonight. Just mixing up the groups again, wanting to see a small ball lineup. I thought it went well. You know, LeBron is LeBron, and then he caught fire a little bit in that first half, but I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased. Again, I just told my group, we don't want to ever get accustomed to losing and get comfortable with losing, but this time of the year is just about, it's not so much about the final score as it is about seeing that you're improving and your principles are being adopted and embraced and carried out. And I thought all of that happened today.
You talked about on offense, the four out and the one in, and it seemed like the spacing was even improved from last game.
Yes.
Angles. How do you see the players picking that up, and how does that evolve?
Well, it's just running habits and opening up space and knowing that with guys like Russell and Bron and K-Nunn and Dennis when he gets here, like those guys attacking the paint and going hard toward the rim, the defense is going to have to collapse, or you know, going to have multiple bodies trying to get in front of them and try to contest them at the rim. So it's going to open up. Like if you sacrifice and sprint to the corners, you're going to get a hell of a lot of corner threes attempts. And you know, we feel comfortable in everybody on our team shooting those shots. So it's just a matter of sacrificing through habits in order to make the greater good for the team in terms of floor balance and, you know, having guys knowing that they attack, defense collapse, there's somebody waiting on them to receive the pass.
Darvin, do you have an update on AD?
Yeah, we just got ahead of that in terms of he had a little bit of back tightness, lower back tightness, but we just wanted to get ahead of it. You know, this thing is going to be a marathon, and we need him to be available and healthy, and so we're not going to try to play hero and force him to be a hero to be out here for game two of a preseason game. And when we need him, you know, once we start October 18th, everything is geared toward us being able to be set a tone from that first game throughout the whole entire 82 game season. So it was just us being precautionary.
And speaking of toe setting, what did you think of LeBron's defensive energy?
I thought it was great. He was great off the ball. We had some clips that we showed at halftime. He was great contesting the rim, great on the ball. And when he's buying into it, you know, it's hard for those other guys to be disobedient, for lack of a better term. You have to be able to work and coach your best players, and they have to be able to buy in and be willing to show and prove on that end of the floor, that side of the ball. Like I said, defense is something that we're going to hang our hat on, and we're going to figure out ways to score. It's almost 70 points in the first half, so that's going to take care of itself. We got talented offensive players, but the defensive end, being committed night in and night out to that end, is really going to allow us to compete at a very high level and have a lot of success.
First, a quick follow on AD. Is it possible? I know you guys didn't plan for AD to play tomorrow, but is it possible that he plays tomorrow?
No. Okay. No, he won't be playing.
And then, you know, 16 offensive rebounds by the Suns, and you mentioned the defensive rebounding struggling the first game, and obviously when you have a smaller lineup,
yeah,
it's going to be more. What kind of adjustments did you see, especially in the first half, that the group made to try and get that under control?
You know, you tend to float a little bit. Like if a shot is taken, you're on defense, and no one is in your area, tend to stand and turn and watch instead of turning, engaging toward the ball, getting toward the paint, putting, okay, there's no individual body for me to put my body on, and I got to go help my teammate put two bodies on one body. And I just thought guys looked, they were looking to do that more and just flying in and getting multiple hits and multiple guys going after the rock. So it's something that's going to be a constant theme, us finishing our defense. You know, with a rebound, holding teams to one possession, that's going to be a common theme throughout the season.
Darvin, I have two for you. Other than AD not playing tomorrow, do you expect to rest anybody else?
Yeah. I mean, I don't mind saying, sharing, like AD won't play, Russ won't play, Brian won't play. You know, I think Pat Bev may maybe 50-50. I don't know, but no, they won't play in the back-to-back.
And what do you make of the bench being called for a technical foul? I think it was assigned to Russ. I know you got out.
Well, my interpretation of the rule was that, you know, it's okay for them to show excitement on a spontaneous play, which that was. I think the only problem was, I think Russ, you know, the way it was explained to me was that Russ came onto the floor. So I have to go back and look at the video. But, you know, I get when it can be, you know, a little bit excessive and guys are standing up and chirping and doing all that. You know, the game that's been within the game for years and years and years. But I don't also want to, same token, I don't want, you know, a situation, an environment where they can't be celebratory toward their teammates. But rules are rules, and they have them in place for a reason, so we just have to respect them like the entire league does and just try to move forward in the best way possible.
Coach, wanted to get your thoughts on Austin Reaves today. Really good playmaker from him, was good on the defense end, was getting a lot of rebounds too as well. Just wanted to get your thoughts.
Yeah, Austin is like a Swiss Army knife, man. You know, he can play a little point guard, shoot it, defend, scrappy, flying in there to get rebounds. Hands were really, really active tonight. A ton of deflections, and him pushing the break and willing to put his body on the line, willing to dive on the floor. Like, he's going to be a really, really valuable piece for us as we try to turn this thing around.
Darvin, like you said, LeBron was LeBron. You know what I mean? The bounce was there, the energy was there, all those good things that you've come to expect. What has the process been like for you, though, in building a coach-player relationship with him, a guy that, and you've been around him on the periphery for a long time, but what's that like trying to build that? How have you gone about forging that bond with him?
Well, with LeBron, man, it's easy going, man, because, you know, he's aware of who he is, and he's a highly confident player. But he's also aware of his teammates. You just look at his history. He's also a guy that's always, you know, held his teammates in high regard and being about the team and playing the right way. So it hadn't been difficult at all. You know, he's. I don't think we've had one conversation about him sitting me down or us having a meeting about where all of his shots are going to come from and where, you know, I want the ball here and I want the ball here and I want the ball here. Like, it's been kind of organic. I've been around the league now for 26 years. He's been around playing this is his 20th season. So I think it's been more collaborative than anything. And we have a great staff, you know, guys that have a ton of history with him. And, you know, I think he's a joy because he listens. He tries to help figure things out on both sides of the ball. And it's going to be a great partnership. You know, it's long gone are the days where, you know, as a coach, you got to be willing and able to make final decisions, but the process leading to that decision is more collaborative these days. It's more of a democracy than a dictatorship. And when you have high-level players like that, you can't be afraid to collaborate with them, pick their brain, and let them see what you're seeing, and then meet somewhere halfway. And there'll be times where I want it to be done a certain way. There'll be times where I'm going to relent and, you know, you know what, you guys might be right. Let's try it your way. And that's just the nuances of coaching a team at this level and having Pat Bev, another high IQ defensive mind. Like, it's, they're all over the place. So it would behoove me to embrace that and not reject it. But, you know, that our relationship has been awesome. It's been what you would expect up to this point.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep.